everybody, and welcome to REZOcast episode 25. This is Lego, and I'm here with Hove and Triton, and our special guest from the Destiny community, Chadlantis. Welcome, man. We're so glad to have you here. This week, I feel like for me, has all been about remembrance of, you know, raids of old, or maybe it's some stuff from the community, or maybe it's my own personal PvP experiences, just looking back on everything that I've done. I don't know. It's got me in this like nostalgic mood with all the old raids coming back. Hove, how's your week been, man?
Pretty good. I haven't done too much Destiny stuff. I actually started playing some more Overwatch. I know it's a weird week to start playing Overwatch, but I mean, it's exciting to get some new stuff coming back. You know, I think we can all agree with that. I'm sure, you know, some people have different opinions on it, but it's something in what we've, you know, kind of already established as the end of the game. So I'm happy with it. Triton, you awake?
I'm Waco. I'm messaging you. Obviously, picks that can't be shown on stream for various reasons. So that's what you're getting messaged right now. But we played Destiny a fair amount this week. I mean, we missed REZOcast trials, or I did on Monday, which was regretful. Unfortunately, couldn't keep our somewhat regular or irregular tradition together. But did play Iron Banner when it was up. You know, still enjoying some of the new stuff because I haven't been playing it as much because I've been sucked into Horizon. And I'm going to try not to derail this podcast because I know Chad's playing that as well. But Chad, how's your week been so far besides the Horizon, maybe just the Destiny?
It's actually been awesome. Branched out a little bit more into variety this week starting. So I did actually some H1 and Horizon as well, of course. But I also, for Destiny, I started an ultimate account so I can do some of the nostalgic stuff now with still feeling like I'm gaining something from it, which is cool.
So now you can beat us in trials and we won't even know it's you this time.
Yeah. Got a bit of a troll name for that new account too, so it'll be pretty funny if I go off on people.
Oh my gosh. Well, before we keep going into more Destiny stuff, we want to get to know you a little bit, Chad. I know a lot of people here in our live chat know you already, but I just want to know, like, you know, if someone were to come to your Twitch or your YouTube page, what would they find? Where do you feel like you fit into the Destiny community?
For the Destiny community, I've done a lot of PvP a lot. When I started off, it was raid carries, just Vault of Glass, Crota's in, raid carries. All I did was just raid stuff all the time. And I kind of got bored of it, so I switched over to PvP stuff, Trials of Cyrus help, pretty much since like King's Fall kind of came out. A couple of months after that is when I was like, I want to do some exciting like PvP stuff. I'm kind of just bored of the raid carries. I love it when people do that. It's just, after nearly 2 years of that straight every day for like 10 hours, I need to do something else.
For real, sure. Man. I can't believe, so you started as more of a PvE player in Destiny?
Yeah, I was definitely a PvE guy. I did PvP every once in a while like that, but it wasn't my focus. It was definitely PvE, just doing raid stuff pretty much.
So what do you feel like changed? Was it just doing, you know, the PvE content over and over again? You're like, man, I need something new experience, and PvP kind of offered that for you, you feel like?
Yeah, from my perspective, how I feel is PvE is a lot of patterns, and you just kind of figure out the optimal pattern and just do that. And you don't really do anything else. And if you don't do that optimal pattern with the optimal gear loadout, you feel like you're just not doing it well enough. So you feel like you're like wasting your time and the time of your people you're doing raids with because you're not doing it as fast as possible. I was like, man, I want to do something that's optimal and always is like in an environment that's constantly changing. And PvP is against other players. So you're constantly having to adapt and always change. So it was more exciting and entertaining for me personally.
Yeah, that was definitely kind of, you know, I think I've touched on this before, but, you know, PvE by nature is going to get more boring and more monotonous as you go. Because like you said, it is the same thing. It's a pattern. You do the same thing every time. Whereas PvP, even if it's the same, you know, meta and the same maps, you got other stuff going on, you know, different players and the way they play. And it does help keep things fresh a little bit. I mean, you know, we're in year three, so I wouldn't call fresh a priority, but, you know, it helps a little bit, I guess.
But to continue what Hove was saying, and what you were kind of talking about with that, you know, gradual, like doing something to the best that it can be done. I'm curious in PvP, if you feel like it's still a continual like ladder to climb of getting better, or do you feel like in Destiny you can kind of peak a little bit?
As far as mechanical abilities, it's kind of a peak as for sure, because there's a lot of cheese factors in Destiny's meta with like I mean, if you talk about Trials itself, then it's kind of like you just sit there with Scory and hard scope your sniper, whip out our sidearms right now. That's pretty much what everybody does. Especially for a Warlock, you can very easily kind of get to a peak because it's literally just hit your R1 button a bunch, and then every once in a while, R1, R2. Every 25 seconds, you hit an L1? Yeah, L1. So, I don't know. Mechanically, it kind of feels like you get to a peak. And I feel like I've gotten to a mechanical peak outside of just general practicing to make sure my primary shot's on point with like a palindrome or whatever. I started getting to sweats a bit, and I definitely had a lot of lessons to learn in that because obviously it's a new environment. You have to do zone control now or supremacy or just general clash. You have to learn how to look for angles and not get caught out and rotate with the team, look for all that stuff. So team strategy-wise, there's a lot to learn there that I didn't know about.
Absolutely, yeah.
And like pubs, regular crucible, everybody just running around whatever, so it doesn't really matter. Yeah. I just kind of don't miss position personally, but you don't have to like coordinate anything. So there's things to learn here and there in general strategy, but it definitely gets to a point where you feel like you peak out.
Yeah, I'm curious, out of all those things you just listed that you've tried in all the different game types, is there one that like sticks out as your favorite? Like, is there something that's like your thing more than anything?
I definitely enjoy forest sweats more than anything else.
Wow.
Pubs, I can't really like get into it that much because there's just chaos and like you don't really have coordination. And trials is a lot of cheese that you have to deal with. Yeah. So it's just like, I feel like a lot of times you don't really feel like you got beat like by skill. You kind of just were unlucky sometimes. But as in sweats, you have to figure out how to coordinate really well with your team. You have to do map movement and rapidly like optimize pathing. And it just feels like a higher skill ceiling there, especially since they integrate their own rules from like Farcog and their whole like right. Sweat council, they call it.
Yeah. So, the sweat council.
It feels a lot more competitive and more of a competitive environment for sure. I enjoy it more personally.
Well, that's definitely something that we found out quickly and we've talked about on the podcast, but it feels like it's relevant right now. Right when they first announced that they were doing, you know, game battles and tournaments and everything, I had played some like friendly pickup sweats and everything. Lego hadn't really. And a clanmate of ours was like, "Hey, do you guys want to put together a team and play in this tournament?" We're like, "Yeah, sure." So it was him, me, Lego, and another guy that Lego and I had never even played with, didn't know him. And he's like, "Oh, hey, tomorrow night I set up a scrimmage against a team of some people I know. So let's go ahead, you know, we'll play them at, you know, 8 o'clock or whatever." Well, we get there and we practice, we play a couple games, and he goes, okay, they're ready. Yeah, it was Dr. Lupo, Ninja, Ramblin', and one of his friends. So we learned real quick the difference in serious sweats and how much teamwork matters when we got just absolutely
demolished. Gosh. Dude, it makes me want to go back and try it again, though, because we kind of got a bad, like, you when you face off against the best for your very first time, you're like, okay, we're starting real low here, you know? But the way Chadlantis is talking about, you know, the way Forz is his favorite right now and the movement and the teamwork, it makes me want to go back in and try it again, because especially with this new meta, and I know things are feeling different, which was one of my questions to you, Chad, and that was, you know, after this new meta hit, is Forz, do you feel like it's better, worse? Like, what are your opinions on your favorite way to play right now?
Definitely feels like it's slower paced because of the special loss. A lot of people are trying to hold like the gentleman's agreement to not use sidearms. Is not an official rule set or anything right now to not use sidearms, but some people still whip it out and it's pretty good if you whip that out. But it's just a lot of laning and making sure you get the team shot going. Solo outplays aren't as prevalent. There's not as many times with the old meta where if you have like a shotgun ready, you can just go in, just you see an opening, you go for it and instantly kill like two or three dudes on the other team and make a crazy big play. That doesn't really happen much anymore. It can if you have special ammo, but even if you do, shotguns are still nerfed. So the overall play is a lot slower than it was on the previous meta. But honestly, in my perspective, because I didn't really get into sweats until just when that meta shifted and the patch hit, it was actually really nice for me because beforehand when I got into sweats, I didn't really get to learn the fundamentals very much because I would go into a game and just people didn't really have fundamentals, but they were mechanically really good and fast paced. And they just go around slaying people with shotguns going all crazy. But now you have to know fundamentals. You have to know about team movement. You have to know about rotating and looking for angles and properly knowing when to use your supers, approaches like that. So the whole lone wolfing, I just went off on people and won the game by one play kind of thing, doesn't happen as often. It's more of like fundamental. So it's better to get into sweats now to learn all that stuff, to when the meta shifts to go faster pace, hopefully in the future, you'll know all that groundwork and then you can go and apply that with making plays, which is pretty nice.
Nice. I think I'm sold, guys. I think I'm going to do this again soon. I think I'm going to give it a shot. Hove, Triton, you with me sometime or what?
Yeah, I'm down.
Yeah, if you want to do sweats, I'm sure we'll find time to do that.
You sound so excited.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I mean, like, I've never really heard too much of a raving experience from anybody that's ever been on the show. No one's ever been like, I mean, we've never had like a sweats champion on here or anything. So it's either people learning, although Chad had a really good breakdown of kind of the lessons he's learned in a very short amount of time, which I think is impressive. But I've heard that story where you guys have got destroyed by Lupo and Ramblin' and Ninja a couple times, like, and from Hope in person over a meal. So I mean, I've definitely heard that story a fair amount.
I mean, we've turned one of those things much to it. It's so ridiculous, like.
But Chad, anyway. I'm curious, when you're talking about sweats and you're talking about kind of the evolution of that and everything else, you know, when you think about Destiny 1 coming to a close, you know, we just kind of got like our Age of Triumphs for all of Destiny 1 yesterday. You know, when you talk about the evolution and where it's going to be with Destiny 2, you know, what does the sweats community kind of feel like in terms of, you know, when Destiny 2 comes out, is it going to be a complete shift and everything will change? Or are there those going to be those folks that play Destiny 1 and that's going to be kind of the competitive scene for a period of time until, you know, things are more known in Destiny 2? I'm just curious because I've never had that conversation with anybody.
Right. Destiny 2 is a great unknown right now because we know basically nothing about it. So it's hard for anybody to say we want to completely just leave Destiny 1 and go to Destiny 2. But so many people want a better, more fair and competitive environment, one where they don't really necessarily need to implement so many gentlemen's agreement rules that currently happens, but actually like have locked in like forced rule sets. And maybe even a meta where we aren't required to have our own individual rules made by Farcog, that the game is just good enough as is that we can just go play it. Also, so many people are hoping for 60 FPS and better server stability and all that stuff that everybody's kind of just assuming they'll just full switch to Destiny 2 and leave Destiny 1 behind as far as competitive goes. I haven't heard anybody talk about, man, I don't want Destiny 2 come yet. I just love Destiny 1 so much.
Right.
Pretty much everybody's already just jump on board and just go into Destiny 2 and just move forward from there.
Yeah, from the sweat community. So from the sweat community's perspective, it can only go up, right? Like, it can only get better, you would think.
Yeah, a lot of them speaking about how, like, right now is probably the least competitive and least exciting meta that's ever been and place that's ever been in sweat community, which is weird because while the game state has seemed to be shifting downwards to be less competitive and less interesting, Farcog and all those guys in Sweat Council and even like thing like ESL is getting into it and all that, like there's more exposure and they're getting better structure for competitive Destiny, as competitive as it can get. So while they're getting better structure, the game's kind of declining. So we're hoping that Destiny 2 is going to be like really set a great experience meta-wise and game-wise with the structure already established, and it's just going to take off right off the gate, which is going to be really cool if it does.
Yeah, and that leads me to one thing that I hadn't heard anyone talk about in a while, and it just kind of popped into my mind that, you know, even with games like Halo that were very competitive, there were still things, much less, but still things that were banned or, you know, that they changed and everything. And one thing people haven't talked about a lot is, you know, we got a very, very basic, private games with some custom features. No one's really mentioned since those came out the possibility of more in-depth custom stuff in Destiny 2, whether it comes at launch or later, you know, being able to limit weapons or limit supers, change map geography, whatever it may be, gravity, you know, that's something that was in Halo and is in other games and would really make things much easier. You know, it would eliminate, like you said, gentlemen's agreements. Well, if we decide you don't use it, we're just going to say, look, click, you can't use it. You know, and that would help even things out too.
That'd be really nice. That would be even better for people getting into sweats too, because right now it's so many questions of what exactly is banned? Can I run this? Is this enough lines? Like when I first got into it, my biggest question was, is my armor and recovery too much right now? Because there's no number states. It's just a bar. You have to visually kind of just guess if it's there. And Farcog provided like a whole list of you can run these stats with these combos and all that stuff. But it's like, it's just so many numbers you have to look at and decipher. I'm just like, I just ask a veteran, is this good enough? And they'll tell me yes or no, just by feel of looking at the bars. So a lot of the questions for people, newcomers getting into sweat communities, a lot of confusions, concerns, stop a lot of those things where people will like whip out like a No Land Beyond mid match, get one snipe and put it away real quick, and hopefully nobody saw it or something. Like,
oh my gosh.
That, wait, that happens?
No way. As far as like the higher tier sweats, that never happens. I've never seen it. But okay. In like pickups and stuff, people will just do shenanigans because they only have the respect there, you know? So,
right. Yeah.
Hove, you got me thinking for Destiny 2, you know, like there's a lot of stuff that could be in it, you know, and that they could reveal over time. And the way that they do the reveals right now, like this month in March, they're like, here's the reveal stream for this. Here's the reveal stream for this. Could you imagine the hype train they're going to pile on for actual Destiny 2? Like it's going to be like, once they start releasing stuff, it's just going to be this slow drip of like every, like I bet it's going to be like every day potentially rather than every week with how close the release is going to be, you know, like to when they announce it. It could be like, oh, here's an option for this in private matches that we haven't told you about yet. Here's this set of armor you haven't seen yet, you know. I don't know.
We hope it's a slow drip and not like some of the other ones where they tell us everything.
Well, I kind of hope that there's a lot that they keep secret, you know, that we just don't know at all. But as far as stuff like customization, tell me everything. Like, I want to know, you know. Because I think that will get the PvP community really hyped, especially the sweat community and tournaments and everybody who organizes that stuff. Like, what if there was a drop down? Like, what if they talked to the sweat? I don't know if this is even possible. But what if, like, there were pre-saved, like, settings you could do in the matches that, you know, an organization put out that you could, like, I don't know, download, or if Destiny looked at one specific organization. I don't know if anything's ever even been done like this in a console game, but like, hey, here's the settings for PvP tournaments in general, and you just click it and that you're in the game type, then you don't even have to change any settings. I'm like dreaming right now. I don't even know if any of this is possible.
I guess that's possible, but I don't know. I would still be a long way down the road, but I mean, you never know. Activision owns MLG, so... Who knows?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
I still think that would be... I think you are dreaming.
Like I am, yeah. I like to do that on this podcast. Speaking of dreaming, though, I was thinking of kind of dreaming, remembering. I said at the beginning of the podcast, I'd just been remembering a lot of stuff from year one and everything, and I was thinking about one of your YouTube videos you put out a little while ago, Chad, about... That was like, hey, here's some trials run from year one. You know, so much has changed since then. And I was thinking about myself and even just last week with Nava Bear, we were talking about coming from other games and how, like, when I came to Destiny, there's so much that I never even thought about before that I think about now, like, down from movement to cover to teamwork to call outs. Like, I used to be more of a lone wolf that you were talking about and didn't really. You know, put all of that into practice. It was just like, okay, am I aiming better than I was yesterday, basically? Are my shots more on point? And there's so much more to that in a team first-person shooter. And so I'm curious for you guys, all three of you really, like, what do you feel like you've learned over the course of Destiny? What has Destiny taught you that maybe other games haven't, or that, you know, this community has taught you that maybe other games haven't?
Oh man, I was so bad in year one of those videos.
Dude, me too, man.
So like, in year one is a really good example of that compared to now for what you're talking about. Because in those videos, my accuracy is basically as good as it is now. And my reaction speed, if anything, is probably even slower because those are years ago and I'm just getting older.
Did you say your erection speed? Is that what you said?
Reaction speed. Oh, yeah. Jesus, like, my erection speed, probably. I am getting older. But,
I never get to throw one in. It was too perfect.
But yeah, I talked about this on my stream a few times about how I've kind of regret wasting a lot of my years of my youth because I've always was as competitive as far as like wanting to win as I am now when I was younger. And I played Call of Duty 2 on PC and I went on from there on FPSs. That's the first FPS I ever like seriously played was that. And that's a long time ago. I was in the clans. I did like tournaments like that. I was always really good at landing shots. My reaction speed was good, not erection speed, but it's just, I never thought about strategy. It's never occurred to me. My only thought process in FPS gaming was, I need to shoot that guy as best as possible, as fast as possible, and not miss my shot. And then after I do that, I need to just go and run and find whoever else I can find on the map. If there's red, I'm going to it. And I just go to the red, and it goes seek target, kill target. Next target, go target, kill target. There's no like flanking involved, really. There's no like the most next level thinking I ever did was, my brother was playing Modern Warfare 2 and asked, bro, how do you always find these opportunities to kill so many people? Every time I play the game, there's just like all my teammates there, and we just like keep shooting together. I don't gain kills. He's like, all I do is I see where my team is and I go the other way. I'm like, okay. So I would just do that too. I just go the other way. And that's how I started my flanking strategy. It was just that simple logic. But it wasn't until like a year ago, about a year ago, is when I really started like sitting there like, why am I not winning? And that's when I started getting the trials carries more. And while trials is kind of like how people meme is mostly true, part of it is just, you really do have to think about a lot of strategy with like orb control, when to use your supers effectively, how to don't get caught out by yourself. If you do die, die in a place that your team can cover from, try a team shot with people. There's just so much strategy goes into that I've learned over the year. It's probably been a little bit over a year since then, actually, but I never thought about it. And I really wish I did when I was younger, just because I just didn't think it was even like a thing. I didn't think about strategy at all. I just thought to go kill stuff. So that's something I'm trying to share with experience with a lot of people, especially like younger people, viewers of my channel, anybody I talk to, is you have a lot of skill. Just think about like strategy. You can land shots all the time. You just don't know what to do outside of shooting your gun, you know? And that's something I wish I learned a long time ago, and definitely learned through Destiny primarily, is a lot better player now than I ever was, even though my shot might be even worse than I was when I was younger, just because I know all that strategy stuff and I never thought about it before.
Yeah, I'm like completely on board with you, like on all of that stuff. I think the number one thing for me is the community and like learning to review my own gameplay and asking that question that you asked, you know, why am I not winning? Why did I lose that engagement? And actually watching myself or hearing feedback from other, like playing trials with other people, you hear like, oh man, like maybe you shouldn't have gone out there and done that. Like I do this, you know, and you're like, oh, and you're learning from other people. And every other game I played, even if it was a team game like Battlefield or something where you play with other people, I didn't really talk with anyone or play on a team where we were close friends where they could tell me, hey, you're doing that wrong, and not just yell at me, you know, or something like that. So that is definitely it for me too. Hove, Trident, what about you guys?
What was the original question?
What do you feel like Destiny has taught you in a shooter that maybe other games haven't, or since you've been here, like something that you've learned that you've gotten better at? Nothing, you're perfect.
There was something about, you asked something about the community before, because I was going to say that nobody's ever happy, or everybody's never going to be happy. That's what I was going to say, that the community's taught me.
That's what you've learned.
No matter what you do, no matter what changes so they've made. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah, no, I do know what you mean.
Please everybody. But
that,
no,
that is a huge thing to learn for sure. Because with Destiny, it is one of the first communities where there's so much feedback, at least for me, that I've been involved in the community to see all of that feedback and to see how many people are never happy, you know?
No, in all honesty, I mean, really kind of a similar answer. You know, the shooters I had played in the past, it was mostly just, hey, I have a PS4, whatever system, and maybe I have a friend that I'll play online with, but it was the same thing. Like, you couldn't have put it any better, Chad. Like, I see red on the radar, like, run to it, try to kill somebody, run the next one, try to kill someone. And, you know, just this game by design, you know, being in Resolute and having a clan and being in a community where I've played with so many more people, you have to learn strategy and teamwork. And we've talked about that a lot. And it actually made me think, there was a friend of mine, he played Destiny. He hasn't played recently. And we had an argument one day. He's really, really good, just much better player than I am. But we always used to like mess with him because he would tell us flat out, he'd run off and like try to get clips in trials, and then like he dies or we die and whatever. And
are you referencing me right now?
No, Dom.
No, you just let us die, Lego, and then you get your clips. Okay. Like, you're like, I got your back, guys, and then we're both dead. You're like, oh, I'm on the other side of the map.
Oh, I'm getting special. Don't mind that. I have to get special. Yeah. But no, we had an argument, and it was basically the whole, you know, team shot and strategy versus gun skill. I told him, you know, I would take 9 times out of 10, three average gun skill players who play really well in team shot as a team over three high gun skill players who just run around by themselves. I said that the team shot teamwork people are going to beat you 9 times out of 10. And, oh, fuck that. Like, I'll snipe everybody. And I'm like, well, you can snipe one of them, but if they're all shooting you, they have to shoot once and then you're dead. Like, so yeah, that is really a big thing. I didn't mean to, you know, repeat and steal your answer, Chad, but that's all I got.
No, that's good.
Oh, for sure. I think strategy is definitely a more important skill than gun skill, because like, even if you're two bad players, more than likely two versus one, you're going to beat the other person. So strategically, if you put yourself at an arms race, you're going to outgun people. To become a great player, having no gun skill, like, okay, so strategy you can teach, right? But you can't teach people how to have gun skill. Right. So I think having at base a foundational advantage would be gun skill as a priority, because if you don't have gun skill, like, can't really help you improve at all.
Right.
But I like it when people have great gun skill, because I can help them improve in strategy. Whereas people know great strategy can't optimize or capitalize on advantages they find, then they just didn't capitalize on it, and right, it's just impossible for them because they can't land their shots. But equal, both important, both definitely important qualities. Strategy more so important, though. You can teach strategy, you can't teach gun skill.
Very true.
Like, I'd say for me, the thing I've learned the most is if you spend enough time with Hove, your chances of picking up hostesses and waitresses is like 8 times greater than before you ever met Hove. Like, it's uncanny, even though at this time in my life where I really can't benefit that, you know, with that skill at all anymore, just like watching Hove in action is just, it's like Rembrandt with paint. I mean, I just can't, it's just amazing. And that's really what I've learned the most, is that if you look like Hove and carry yourself like Hove, that you will never pay for your meal and you'll probably live with a
none of this is, I mean, true at
all. That's so true. It's so true.
I don't know this story, but it sounds like a great time.
He just makes it up every week. He adds more to the story.
I'm not more adding to the story. Okay,
I met a girl named Mindy who was a hostess. We dated. She became a stripper. I dumped. There's this whole backstory that is completely fake. Triton tells people we went to college together. I met him last year. Like,
I honestly don't know what's true and what's not anymore. It all kind of flows together now.
Yeah, it's actually getting pretty tough. I mean, now that we've done it for so long, to like really keep track of what it is. But no, actually, I mean, for Destiny, it's the only game that I've ever thought more about, like, you know, just playing by myself. I think this is the first game I've really been a part of any community that I've played for probably more than, you know, 6 or 7 months as like an adult. Like, when you're a kid and like the only games you get are like birthday or Christmas, you're forced to do that. But now, you know, you can play a different game like every couple of weeks. And, you know, here we are having a Destiny podcast in year three of a game. So I think that in and of itself has probably just been something that sometimes I think about, like, wow, that's crazy. But, you know, in terms of some of the other stuff, I think, you know, just moving out of that question, because there's really enough, not much for me to say after the Hove comment. I'm curious for, you know, kind of Chad's analysis of the Sweats community. Like, so for me, I would think when you say like gun skill is like a very base, so like the higher levels, that's like a given. When you talk about strategy, it's interesting because I feel like that there's a greater margin in winning with based on strategy than gun skill. Like, if everyone's really good, then all of a sudden that's extremely mitigated. Like, as someone who works in sports at the highest level, I mean, there's some athletes who are great, but everyone's a great athlete. So at that point, you're really not separating yourself too much most of the time. But the people that take care of their bodies, the people that, you know, don't go out and, you know, get no sleep, tend to do better. So when you talk strategy there, is it kind of something where you feel like if you are really good at strategy, that would separate you more at the higher levels more than gun skill, and kind of the inverse at the lower levels?
Yeah, for sure. I think at the lower levels, you escalate rapidly based on gun skill. And at the higher levels, you escalate rapidly based on strategy. Because at the higher levels, like, pretty much everybody lands their shots. It's not that often people will like consistently miss shots. If they do, it'd be like once every like every other gunfight or something. But you'll even be able to see, I never really noticed it until I learned the strategy, because you can't really like understand what's going on exactly until you really experience it yourself and learn that yourself. But when I started getting into Sweats, I actually started watching people's scrims against other Sweat teams. And I even see sometimes in like actual tournaments, some people just don't know, for like zone control, for instance. In zone control, capture three zones. Pretty much everybody has a home flag, which would be A or C. And then they try a battle over B. And if they're running into a wall with B. Then they got to like try to do like a flank and try like either capture the enemy holding flag to try to reset, just try to change the lines on the battlefield, or just at least distract so you can have a breakaway into B cap, something like that, to try to get your two captures. And the easiest way of breaching the lines and getting an advantage is just using a super. And pretty much how people do it is they'll play for picks, and then when somebody has a super, especially like a roaming super, then the coordinate with the team saying, I'm about to use like a storm trance. So I'm about to use my storm. And then people like on their team will position well, get ready to push lines. And after the storm is activated, they'll like the big distraction, like everybody's like, kill the storm. We need to kill that guy. He's going to wipe our whole team. But while they're all trying to kill a storm, if your team's coordinated and knows that strategy, they're there to pick off the people who are distracted, getting the easy flanks, shooting easy shots. You can easily land shots if you don't have the stress of this guy shooting back at me. You're just taking time and lining up the shots. And while it's happening, you can take control of the spawns you want. You can take the zone you want. Hopefully get like a team wipe or at least three people down so you can take a cap while it's happening. But some teams don't really know how to do that. They just pop a storm and they'll just go off like, oh, we killed two or three dudes. I got two or three dudes down. Let's go. Let's go. But then their teammates didn't know that was really happening, so they have the time to prepare the positioning. Right. So there's a lot of those little intricacies that happen in all three game types. Not so much in Clash. I think Clash has probably the least amount of strategy as far as team coordination, outside of just looking for angles and spacing out supers, kind of basic. But Supremacy is really important for strategy, and Zone Control is probably the most strategic-oriented game type just because of that map control needed for the captures, you know, so... I think there's a lot of teams that can learn a lot from a strategy like that. I don't know. I think gun skill at the top level is pretty much everybody just shoots those shots correctly. The only thing to really learn to get to that top level is just strategy and knowing how to be a good teammate.
So, Chad, I'm curious, if you don't mind sharing, what do you do for a living? No, this is the point. Because when did the meta change exactly? Because I mean, we're talking like inside of a month, right?
Right.
So for someone who had not been doing any sweats up until that point, right, who has just dived into it and is now talking every topic we've had on here so far, you hit this huge discussion that makes sense to somebody who doesn't play any sweats rather quickly. So I'm very, very curious as to what you actually do, because you also said you streamed 10 hours every day doing raids. So somebody that dives into that degree, I'm very curious what you do on your not gaming time as to like either what leads to that, like furthers it, or is the complete opposite so that this is your outlet to do that in.
In life, I had a really good foundation, and I went to college and got like a bachelor's in business administration, so like that. Got a really great paying desk job. It was like in a cubicle, and I hated life 9 to 5. It was 3:30 to 5. I got a 30-minute lunch. But it was a really good paying job, but I knew I didn't enjoy it. And I figured, you know, I don't care if I'm making money, because if the majority of my time spent is doing something I don't enjoy, why am I doing this? So I spent over a year just saving. I didn't spend like any money at all. Really good paying job, and saved money, made correct, like smart investments and stuff like that. And basically just decided to do like streaming, YouTubing and stuff like that full time. Here and there, I'll do like some gigs if I need to do it for a little money and stuff like that. I'm nowhere near wealthy or very highly successful streamer at this point in time. But it's definitely something where every single day I feel like I'm enjoying life. As of recent past, like a week ago, I've really made some changes to really make that life enjoyable. I ran to like a dead end. That's for another story, I guess. But I don't know. It's pretty much entirely streaming and YouTube, mostly streaming though. And I feel like I'm just making an impact though. I feel like my life actually has purpose with where I am now, like community leader, helping people learn and grow, providing like a distraction from daily stress or anything like that. And even that personally, playing video games, you know, so.
That's awesome. Yeah. It's cool that you found like what something that you love doing and made it happen, put the work in to like make it happen for you. So that's awesome, man.
Thanks.
Yeah, I didn't think anybody could dive into that degree so quickly unless you had some kind of passion, but here you're trying to make that your career. And I have to say, we've had a lot of people on here that are very good players. I actually follow everything you say about a stress or sweat strategy. And that's not, so, I mean, I don't really care to do that in any way. I'll do it with Hove and Lego and we'll just die and I'll blame it on them. But I think that it's very, I mean, the ability to translate that to somebody else has to come somewhere. And so like everything you're saying and everything you're explaining is like, I probably won't do that because I just want Lego and Hove to die when we play games and blame it on them. But you know, if I did do it, maybe it probably would work. So kudos to you and kudos to you for making a decision like that. I think that's pretty awesome, man.
So since we're talking about like life stuff and community and Twitch and YouTube and all of that, has there been a highlight for you in Destiny since year one? Not in the game necessarily, because I know we've got a Twitter question kind of about that, but is there a something that's happened either in the community or through your Twitch or YouTube that has been really impactful to you, something you can look back on as like a highlight of your Twitch streaming or your community, something that's happened for you?
There's a lot of really cool things that's happened for me, and I've been lucky in a lot of things. One thing that really stands out, though, as far as like just general exposure and successes, is one time that right after Taken King DLC came out, people were talking about the King's Fall, and then later on the Twilight Garrison came out, the exotic. And I was saying there's so many things I can do with this. And my friend, his name on Twitch is More Blue Tent. He's a good friend of mine, and he's like, "Hey, look at this Twilight Garrison thing you can do. You can boost forward and use a sword, a strike, and then you can boost forward again. And you can basically infinitely fly across the sky." I'm like, "That's so cool, man!" Like, my mind. I was like, "What can I do with this?" There's probably a lot of things that are really, really cool to do this. I was thinking about maybe like in Vault of Glass, you can just glide across the jump portion. Obviously, it was like probably the first thing that went to me because I played so much of that raid. But then somebody sent me a link on YouTube that somebody already did that. I was like, I can't do that because somebody already did it. I'm thinking like, what has nobody done yet? And I was going through like all the things in Destiny could do. I was thinking, the ship maze in King's Fall. I could maybe clear that if I jump on like two or three ships first and then clear the rest of the distance. And all of my friends were like, no, I can't do that. That's so freaking far. It's such a long distance, you know? And everybody was telling me I can't do it. But I just sat there for a few hours on night, just like fiddling with it. And actually not only did it on using three ships, but actually cleared the entire thing using only that first jump on ship and cleared the entire distance. And I was like, oh, this is so cool. And then I was like, oh, this is awesome. And a friend of mine's like, why don't you post that on Reddit, you idiot? I'm like, I should probably do that. I've never touched Reddit ever before. I just heard about it. So I made an account, put on Reddit, and actually blew up. And within a week, it hit over 100,000 views. And I was like,
oh my gosh.
Like the highest view thing I ever had before that was like 200. I was like, this is amazing. 200 people watch this. And then suddenly, boom, 100,000 plus. I'm like, I made it. I did something I can like write home about as I made over 100,000 views. But that was really cool. That's probably like, as far as exposure and most people like seeing something I've done, that might be like the coolest thing. Like, one instance.
That's really cool. That's such a cool feeling to do something. You became legend that day, you know, something no one else had done. It's the goal of Destiny, right?
What kind of sucks about that is I've always won the movie of the week emblem, and when I figured out how to do that was like right when Christmas was about to hit, and I posted that for movie of the week submission, and I was like, I gotta get it. I mean, this is a crazy feat. I gotta get movie of the week with this. And then the day after, they announced that they're not going to do this week at Bungie for 2 weeks, which there's no movie of the weeks. I'm like, oh, well, I guess I won't get it with this video. Shucks, missed opportunity.
So, Chad, now that this is like a living for you, and now that you're doing YouTube, you're doing Twitch, you mentioned getting on Reddit and things like that. So how does your audience respond now, and what kind of thoughts do you put into now that you're doing this full time, as opposed when you're doing it purely for enjoyment? And then you just mentioned having that, you know, big thing blow up on Reddit. Do you find yourself not celebrating kind of the smaller achievements that you would have had if you're just doing this for fun, given that you're really trying to kind of make something of this? Or has that been able to kind of still stay pretty similar for you?
I don't really know what you mean by smaller achievements, but I do know that pretty much every achievement is an achievement still. Beforehand, if I was still working, I could only stream like 3 hours at most per day. But now I can stream as many hours as I want per day. I've even done like 48 hour attempts and like that, which I'm not going to probably be doing that as much anymore. But I don't know. I think every day kind of feels like an achievement because every single day I'm able to be there like regularly at all times, pretty much, unless I'm sleeping. But I don't know. I'm available for people all times to always like shine like a joking light on people on something or share a meme with them or just kind of be there as like a presence for a lot of people in the community, which is probably like just being able to do that at all times is really like a just an achievement itself. And I always feel like I'm achieving something because even it's kind of hard. Like even when I take like a vacation, I'm on my phone like all the time and like my community's Discord server on Twitter. I'll even like go into friends' streams and just hang out in there and chat because I'd like it's kind of like an addiction for me, to be honest. Just being there and being available for people is extremely hard to pull myself away because I feel satisfied at all times.
It's kind of like a home in a way. Like you get so used to being with these people, you know?
Yeah. There's actually a time in August last year. It was actually kind of a good opportunity to intern on a movie set. I have a lot of passion for like, film and video. And a friend of a friend was like a locations manager for a movie industry that's coming into like, I live in Florida and they're doing it in Florida. And I was going to do like a 6-week internship with them. And it all kind of happened really sudden, like really instantly. I didn't really like have much time to plan for it happening. And I thought I'd be all whatever. And, you know, I'm going back to working and I'll be probably able to just stream like on weekends, like 1 or 2 days a week. And I can probably do it for like 4 or 5 hours, maybe like one day, because we get like one day off per week. So I can maybe stream like 10 hours that day and really get the time in. But the night before was like my last stream before the 6-week endeavor. And the night before it happened, I actually had to end stream like pretty suddenly because I was like getting brought to tears, feeling like I was going to be taken away from the community and I wasn't going to be there for people anymore.
Yeah.
It was weird, man. It was such a weird feeling because it's like there's just people watching me play video games and I'm just going to play video games all day. But just so many members of the community just felt like family and felt like my day-to-day that just suddenly not being able to do that for such a long period of time, I just got so sad and like depressed and down about it. I was like, I don't even care, this is a good opportunity. It just sucks that I can't be there with so many awesome people and like share laughs with them daily and stuff like that. Luckily and kind of unluckily, the opportunity turned out to be kind of the most miserable experience of my life. So I quit the internship because of sun poisoning and basically like they treated me like a slave on the set and all that stuff.
Oh my gosh.
It sucked. It was the worst job I ever had in my life. And I quit because I was too sick to even show up the next day from sun poisoning and intense sunburn and all that. I had to stand outside from 6 a.m. until 4 p.m. in 100 degree weather. No shade. I could only take a break like every like hour. And that was just to grab like a quick drink or something. I didn't get served lunch, etc. It was just like,
wow,
the worst. This is the worst. I just got yelled at by directors all day. I hated it. It wasn't worth it. But so that kind of sucked as an experience. But luckily, it was such a bad experience that I could justify leaving it and going back to the community.
Yeah.
Go back to what felt like home, you know? Like it felt like I'd have to be taken away from my family, you know? So.
Right. That's really cool. I think we can all relate to some of those feelings too, of like, you know, having this as a community. And it makes me think of other members who had to leave for a little bit and their stories are kind of like the same kind of thing. Like, man, I can't, like, it's almost like too much. Like I have to end it, you know, as quick as possible because this goodbye is too difficult. Like even if it's for a temporary amount of time, but I think like this would be a good time to jump into the community a little bit more since we're talking about them so much and go to some community questions. How do you feel about that, Hove?
I'm down. We'll start with Twitter and anybody in chat who has anything as we're going through Twitter, go ahead and throw them up there.
Yeah.
So let's see. The first one, and this ties into one of the last ones I saw today. Sneakerhead would like to know why you aren't sponsored by Dr. Pepper yet.
They just haven't given the call, man. They just playing hard to get.
Whenever I saw this question, I was like, guys, Chad means so much more to me now. I had no idea. Like Dr. Pepper is so near and dear to my heart. Like in high school, people knew that like if they saw me walking down the hall, I'd probably have a Dr. Pepper. Like it would be like the thing. And even still, I see people from my high school like now, like years later, and they're still like, are you still drinking Dr. Pepper though? Like, that's their first question that they ask me. I'm like, yeah, I mean, it's great.
I love Dr. Pepper. A friend of mine, I've never had that much passion for a drink before, but I respect it. And a friend of mine, Pat, he's like that with Mountain Dew. Every time I see him, he's drinking Mountain Dew. And it's been like that for 5 years. I've known him. And still 5 years later, he still drinks Mountain Dew. Every time I go to his house, there's a whole like 12 pack of Mountain Dew plus some in his fridge as like reserves. He's just always down for Mountain Dew. So if I get a Dr. Pepper sponsorship, I'm going to put a word in for Mountain Dew to sponsor him, probably.
Nice. Dude, Lego. I wish that there's a photo that's hanging in the hallway down the hall, but it's like a little too far away for me to go and walk and go get it right now. But it's me and my wife exiting our wedding venue, and we both have the Dublin Dr. Pepper, like cane sugar ones in our hands, and it's like that's what we walk out with, and it's so cool. I wish awesome. I could go. I'll post it later in the REZOcast Twitter, but it's awesome. And so you know I mean it. I love Dr. Pepper.
It's delicious.
So we'll go to chat for this one. Los Angeles TTV wants to know, how many silly hats does Chad have, and can he put all of them on at once?
I have 28 in total.
Oh my
god. Oh, an actual answer.
I know.
Probably won't be able to put them all at once because it'll just fall over. I'd have to start get some kind of string tying mechanism going on for something to attempt that.
That one was just funny to me because my Twitter profile picture forever, I don't even own the hat, but I was at like one of those souvenir shops on the beach, you know, and I found like a captain hat and someone took a picture of me wearing it. So like Lego and Triton are always like, you should wear that on your stream. And I was like, I can't. I was like, somebody already does that. I was like, Chadlantis, I've seen him do it. I can't do it.
I can do it too.
Tried to like make Hova logo. I was like,
no, I don't even own the hat.
Logo, just because you're already wearing it in your Twitter thing. And he's like, I can't. It can't be my logo. Chadlantis has it.
I actually have my captain's hat right here.
See?
Oh, here we go. Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Hove, where's yours? Y'all could be twinsies right now.
I don't even
Hove doesn't even own it, right? Like, he doesn't even own the hat.
I know. Go back to the beach.
We'll get
my
it.
My logo suggestion was that stripper pole, and nobody has that. God. So, I mean, like, honestly, if we can't do hats, I don't know why that hat didn't.
With, like, a Destiny gun, like, she's holding or something?
Actually, no, it was just the stripper, but we can put a Destiny gun in there.
No land.
All right, moving on. Hey, it's DT asks, as a Trowel Sherpa, do you hope to see it back in Destiny 2? If so, are there any major changes you'd like to see?
I don't know, man. Trials is an amazing platform for a lot of streamers to grow on. Something I've actually shifted away from recently is I don't really advertise that I'm a Trials carry guy. Because a lot of people that would come to the chat would be like, can I get a run? When's the next raffle? Blah, blah, blah. And it made me feel more like a Trials carry bot than a streamer. Mm-hmm. And it didn't really
and then
like
they just leave
the community anymore. Yeah. And I started doing a system of letting people know instantly like where we are on the card, because people just come in and chat, ask where the card is, and then leave. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to do that anymore. If I wanted to be more of an environment of, if somebody's going to come to my channel, it would be to watch a stream just like any other stream. I just happen to also be playing Trials at the time. Having the identity of a Trials carry guy definitely helps with growth, but it's not always necessarily the great kind of growth that you want. So I'd want it to be more of a thing where I want to play with community members, and I do a raffle simply because there's no other fair way of choosing which community member I'm going to play with. But what we're really going to do here is we're just going to keep playing Trials with you guys. But not necessarily like a Trials carry service. Not that there's anything really wrong with that. I know a lot of people do that and they prefer that kind of format for them. And I think having Trials back in Destiny 2 probably will have more cons than pros. Or no, the other way around. Probably will have more pros than cons. Yeah. One, that can help people continue growing the stream. Two, it gives people something to go for on a weekly basis to try like grind out and get that extra gear for themselves. So like that. But I really hope that if they do provide Trials in Destiny 2 as well, that they do so alongside a ranked playlist. Because the huge con with Trials right now, which kind of makes it kind of a terrible experience playing it, mixing a lot of people who used to love doing Trials carries and runs with their viewers kind of stopped playing. In fact, they kind of left Destiny because of it. It's just because there's so many like 3-sec teams. People are just going for the ego and pride and elo boosting and all that stuff and trying to look for that like, oh, I'm a great player because look at my stats. If there was a ranked playlist, that's where people would care about stats. So all those guys looking for pride and ego would go to the ranked playlist. Otherwise, they'll look silly for trying to boost stats in trials. There's always going to be people like that. But I think having a ranked playlist is going to greatly deter people from doing that in trials. That way, when people do want to play with the community members and go for that weekly rewards, they won't have as many like somewhat impossible roads ahead of them with some of the runs that they do with viewers. So hopefully if they do bring in Destiny 2, it's alongside a ranked playlist. If they provide just by itself in Destiny 2, it's probably going to be a lot of what we're experiencing right now. It's just people going to run cheese stuff and just kind of go for pride and ego and just try to ruin people's days, you know, and find out the greatest experience right now.
Dude, I love what you were saying about, like, I feel like that's the best reason, or at least one of my favorite reasons I've heard to have a ranked playlist, is to keep, you know, people from like just farming trials, you know, because I think it's one thing to run with your friends or just, you know, run with stacked teams if they're your, like, that you just want to play with good people, and that's fine, right? You know, but it's another thing to keep resetting your card when you have only 3 wins just to, right, you know, get your elo up or whatever. And so that's a really cool reason, in my opinion, to have a ranked playlist that I hadn't heard before. So that's awesome. I really like that a lot.
All right. So this was asked me in my chat, and I asked, it was RallyBubba74, clanmate of ours, completely inappropriate question, but it was kind of a thinker. So you've heard, you know, I'm sure everyone here has heard the term, go eat a bag of dicks, right? Or something with a bag of dicks. He said, what does that bag look like in your mind? Like, what is the bag?
So you're gonna pick
your bag of dicks.
All right, so the bag is probably, in my mind, it would just be like a plastic bag of dildos.
Like see through.
I would like it to be a paper, like brown plastic, like paper bag, preferably, actually not really plastic. But it reminds me of a funny story. Whenever like Sector 618 came out and like Rusted Lands, I freaking hate Rusted Lands. Anybody from my community would probably attest that I despise that map. I hate it so much for a lot of reasons I probably won't go into right now, but we started calling it Rusted Dicks, and then the Sector Dicks 18 was what we called that map, and we started just going into a lot of funny names about them. And then we just one night a couple of buddies of mine, was Morbid Lieutenant from earlier and another guy named Big Davy Dave, and we're just on the comms and we're like, we have to play this freaking Sector Dicks 18, man. This map could just eat a bunch of dicks, like a truckload of dicks. Like just drive it in there and just dump it all over the map. Just let it eat it. And like Davey just goes like, just airdrop, like air supply, just a whole box of dicks. And then it just escalated from there. And it was, it just got into this point where it was just obnoxious. It was just obnoxious.
How I'm going to think of that every time that map comes up now.
I never even like, When Rally asked me that question, I immediately pictured that it was like a big burlap sack. I don't know why. Like,
yeah. No, me too. Bag. Like a canvas bag or something. Yeah.
Now, I actually asked 2 in real life friends this question. One said plastic bags, and the other one said a black duffel bag with white handles. I don't know why.
That was very specific.
Was this like classy. Mindy or a stripper that you asked this question? Or
Mindy does not exist. Triton, what's your answer before we move on?
I would say like a brown paper bag.
Bag?
Like the same, like, you know, when people like leave like a flaming pile of like shit on your doorstep and it's like in a brown paper bag. It would be like the same type of method of delivery, like just a brown paper bag full of dicks.
All right.
So straightforward.
Moving on. Yep.
That's what it is, period.
Has Ho's name on the bag.
So we got 3 quick ones here from Maurice B.
Ho's always good for a quick one.
He said, what do you want to, 4, I guess, because one of them has 2 in it. What do you want to be when you grow up, and how much wood could a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood?
for the first stream, for the first question, I'm kind of doing it, just streamer, content creator, community leader, playing video games all day and trying to live life to where the focus is having fun and positive impact on other people and just enjoying life. So I'm kind of doing it, just hopefully I can eventually get to a place where it's more successful. But if it does happen, then work for a hobby again. We'll just go back to loop around what I did before. It seemed to work pretty well the first time, so we just repeat. The answer to the second question would be hella.
Good answer. Actually, I don't know why, but this actually came up once before because I remember saying a woodchuck as much wood as a woodchuck could chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood.
And we were all like, all right.
Agreed.
You just need to add hella in there now.
Same.
Another one. Yeah, exactly. Just the whole thing and then hella.
Hella.
All right, another one from Maurice. And this one you kind of answered, but do you think you'll always be a majority Destiny streamer or will you continue to expand the games you play on stream?
Yeah, Destiny feels like home for sure. But kind of felt like I was locking myself down for a while, which wasn't really enjoyable. It started starting to feel like a day-to-day just cubicle job. So I really enjoyed branching out and doing variety, and I probably will continue doing variety frequently throughout the future, but Destiny definitely feels like home, and I cannot freaking wait until Destiny 2, because that's going to be a blast when that comes out. Yeah. That's going to take up all my time. It's going to be Destiny 2, for sure.
All right, and actually, Rally is in chat, and he wanted to thank you for going along with the bag of dicks question and said, you, sir, have another Twitch follower just from that.
Thanks, man. Welcome to the Empire, Rally.
All right, what else we got here?
Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, and his Maurice's last question is, what's your favorite chocolate bar?
Twix. And that classifies as chocolate.
Yeah, I'll take that.
Why not?
What's y'all's favorite? I'm curious.
I know Trident's gonna have something to say about this, but I like Nutrageous.
I mean, you just said it all right there, Ho.
I know.
We don't need to add anything.
Snickers.
Oh, you're boring.
I feel like mine's Butterfingers. The best are the bite-sized ones, or like the BBs. They used to have
Remember the BBs? They were great.
Dude, they were so good. Oh my gosh.
And while we're on quick answer questions, Cheese Nuts wanted to know who your favorite superhero is.
The Flash.
Ooh.
Secondarily, Aquaman, as we discussed today, and if you were lost his ability to get a mod ship because he said he hated Aquaman. But no, I think Aquaman's dope, and Chadlantis is a play on Atlantis. Big fan of Aquaman, but the Flash has always been like, come on, you can't really beat the Flash, and I've been highly biased on that character. So
nice. That's cool.
You guys?
I'm just kind of curious now, like, which version of each he's talking about.
Oh god.
I've avoided Barry Allen, old school.
Especially Justice League Unlimited Flash. Favorite rendition of Flash of all time. That guy was perfect for the character, in my opinion. Aquaman, I've yet to see how the new theatrical version of Aquaman is going to be. Looks kind of badass. I'm kind of excited about it, but I haven't seen it yet, so I can't really say if I like it or not. But probably would go with the Batman the Brave and the Bold Aquaman. It was hilarious. He was just like that man's man version who was somewhat clueless, but it was like really beefy. He was always there taking care of the baddies for Batman. It was great. I loved it.
I feel like that's my reasoning for I like Captain America a lot, and he's just a man's man, you know. I feel like, but at the same time, I'm really digging David from Legion a lot right now. That new TV show, it's really really trippy and awesome and kind of horror like. So of course I would like it, but
I haven't gotten to watch that yet. But I've been told it's amazing.
It's trippy, man. it's a trip.
Wait, Lego, isn't your favorite superhero the Flash? Isn't that why you have Flash at the end of your...
No, it's not. It has nothing to do with that. Really? But
You're a terrible friend. He told us this before.
I don't want to talk about it because I'm like, I feel like Chad Landis is going to kick me off like my own podcast if I talk anything bad about the Flash. So I'm not going to go there.
He told us this before?
Yep, whole thing. But anyway, you're a terrible friend and also forgot where we met, go ahead and tell us your favorite superhero.
I didn't forget that, Hove. I glossed over it one time.
Superhero?
Spider-Man. That's an easy one.
Oh, fuck. You're right. It is Spider-Man, but You stole my answer.
That's like a very common answer, I would imagine. So
no.
Spider-Man, Snickers, paper bag.
The way it is, Chad. You get me. What's your favorite? There's just one answer.
Next question.
That's awesome.
What's your favorite what?
Tree. Pine. Oh, I went up to Hassan at Guardian Con last year, and I walked right up to him. I was like, what's up, Hassan? He's like, how's it going, man? I was like, so what's your favorite kind of tree there? And he just sat there, just like, does he mean weed or actually trees? He couldn't figure it out. You see it in his face. Like, did somebody really just ask me, like, what my favorite tree is? And he's like, do you mean, like, the special kind of tree or, like, actual trees? I'm like, actual trees. He's like, and he was still stumped. He just couldn't think of, like, his favorite tree.
Oh, man. Oak great. Tree is the answer, if you're wondering.
Oak.
Sequoia.
Wintergreen.
Ooh.
Ooh, yeah.
All right, that brings me to my question. Speaking of previously Destiny Con, now Guardian Con, do you have any special outfits or antics planned for this year? And if so, are they revealable or is this a surprise?
Oh, surprise. I'll be rolling in hot, though. Yeah, last year was a really big bang for sure. It was also a good pow and bop and woof. But this year is going to be pretty good, too. I'm excited.
And everyone, look forward to that if you're going to Guardian Con. Last year was, I didn't even know. I was just like, wow, check those guys out. That's funny. Like, I knew who you were, and I saw them, but, like, I never saw you up close. So, like, I didn't know it was you. You know what I mean? I was like,
explain to everyone what you're describing, right? Like describe the scene a little bit.
Well, I could actually get a picture for you probably. Hold on. But yeah, basically I wore like really obnoxious attire for Guardian Con. Because something that came to my mind was I'm going to show up Guardian Con. I don't know people that well. And probably a lot of people are going to have no idea who I am. And I'm just going to be another face in the crowd. I want to kind of show in with some impact. And I was thinking about how I could do that. And I remembered for Pat, the guy I referenced before, the Mountain Dew guy, his wedding, also referencing weddings as Lego did, had really creative groomsmen attire, which I actually couldn't show on my webcam for you. Here, let me blow it up a bit for you. If you can't see that, we're all wearing these like cartoon cutout, like, old school, like Batman style. Here's a close up of my face for a better rendition of it. It's just like giant words all over it. It says like pal right here and like boof and bop and all that stuff all over it. It's like the old school, like funny cartoony bombs on the arms and everything. It was just kind of like obnoxious, like attire that I was like, all right, you know, I could just wear this. And my buddy Dav, who is actually one of my mods and good friends, he was going to Guardian Con with me, so we actually borrowed one of those other guys' suits as well, and he wore that to the Guardian Con. It's actually a great story because I didn't know I could go to Guardian Con until 3 days before, and tickets were sold out for the pre-purchase. You weren't allowed to do that anymore. So we had to show up early. So we showed up early, got in line out the door. We're like 200 people down the line, so we might not be able to make it in at all. A lot of people getting like heat poisoning, heat stroke out from reports that last year, which is a big reason why they're doing prepaid only this year. I think they're not allowing outdoor purchases at all this time, if I remember right.
I think
so get your tickets now.
Do it.
See you there.
Your shirt is not a ticket.
But while we're standing in line, it was somebody from Operation Supply Drop. So personal plug. I don't know what you guys do. Personal plug for those guys. Guy walked up and he's like, Is it just you two guys? Is it just you two? And I went off and asked staff members a question. So he's talking to Dav, and Dav was like, yeah, it's just me and him. And he's like, here's two tickets to get in. Just take them, get in. And the only thing I ask you is you just go up to our booth and just take a picture with us. And Dav was like, all right, I can do that. And so I came walking back in, and he's like, yo, we got in, let's go. And he's like, I was like, what? Like, what the heck? He tells me about that. So we just put on the wristbands. We walk straight in the doors. We just write our names on the check-in or whatever and go to the booth, take a picture, and we're golden. It was really definitely a blessing. So so many things that happened with the suit thing. I'm definitely going to do something similar for this year. I can't not do it.
Jeez. Yeah, I mean, that's a great idea, like you said, especially as someone who's trying to get your name out there and grow as a streamer and content creator. You were you very clearly stood out among all the people there. Like, that was very smart. And it got you in, so.
Yeah. It worked.
All right. Now you know, Hove, we got to decide if you're going to wear a captain's hat too or not. That basically is the question.
Got to come up with something. Got to do something different. We'll figure something out. All three of us are going. We'll figure something out down there. You can pick something out. I'll wear it. I don't care. I'm ridiculous. As long as it's not
wearing
like
jerseys.
Just Triton's going to like pick out like a
jersey and have your own.
That's what Triton's going to try to do.
Triton's
going to
pick like assless chaps. So no.
For Hove? I mean, I've already seen you in that. So why would I? I want everyone to see that.
All right.
I got one more like easy question and then one more serious question, I believe.
Okay.
Brad F1, kind of going on, I think, as we were talking about superheroes, wants to know what movie are you most excited to see this summer? We'll just say this year, period. How about that?
This year. I don't really know exactly what's coming out this year specifically, but I do know Wonder Woman is coming out. And when they play her like theme music with this new Wonder Woman, like they did in Batman vs. Superman, and they did in the trailer too, fell in love, man. That alone makes me want to watch the movie. Just seeing her like do some action scene or some slow motion explosion in the background with that like really edgy song playing. Oh man, I can't.
Now, are you saying you fell in love with the movie or her?
Yes.
I'm gonna have to tell you that she's already mine. So you're gonna have to back off. You can watch the movie all you want. No, I thought the same thing. She looks ridiculously amazing in that movie. Yeah, I'm down.
Yeah,
I agree.
It does look great. I'm not a huge DC fan, but that trailer looked awesome.
Yeah. Spider-Man.
Oh, Guardians of the Galaxy coming out this year,
Ooh,
isn't it?
That's right. Dude, next month.
Yeah, Guardians. All right, in that May. One.
Wonder Woman's great and all, but Guardians of the Galaxy is freaking badass. So I'm excited about the second movie.
Me too. Yeah, that's gonna be
probably
good.
Actually it. I don't know why I didn't think about that one first.
Yeah, Guardians in May, Spider-Man July, Wonder Woman. I think Justice League's end of the year, too.
Yeah,
right?
Justice League's end of year, Thor's end of year. Really? I think Wonder Woman's also in May with Guardians. So
many movies.
Yeah, sorry, and that's just comic book movies.
Out of excitement, I hit my microphone. Sorry. God.
Yeah, it's between Justice Spider-Man and Guardians, too, probably. Although, have you seen Logan yet, Chad?
Yes.
Oh, my Amazing. God. The feels.
Real. The feels. It was real. I'm glad they did it rated R.
Yeah.
Yeah, me
not
too.
That I am out there looking for like goriness and all that stuff, but for the character Wolverine, it makes sense the way they portrayed it, and I like that they did it like a realistic. This is actually what it would look like with Wolverine as a character.
Yeah, cool. It was very well done. You guys,
I feel like there's a lot of horror movies coming out, but I can't think of any of them right now. I just know I have a calendar. My wife made a calendar and she's like, these are the great horror movies coming out this year. And there were so many that I'm really excited about, but I can't remember what any of them are right now.
All right. So Lego has no answer.
I do have an answer. I'm blanking out. I'm still in Destiny mode right now.
Wait, Brad also just pointed out, is Power Rangers come out this year? Because it may be terrible, but that's my childhood.
Yes. 2 weeks from tomorrow.
Oh, it's that soon.
Yeah, 24th.
Yeah. Sweet.
You want to go see it, Ho? We can go see it.
With you? No. What's your answer?
Oh,
I hate you.
Alien Covenant. I'm a huge Alien fan.
That'll be a solid movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. Triton, what do you got?
The one I'm most excited for is the Thor at the end of the year, because I think that kind of will take them into the next phase. So I think Guardians 2 is going to be great. I love Spider-Man. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure they'll do that fine, but that Thor movie, we haven't seen a lot of him. Doctor Strange in it. We talked about it a little bit when we ate the other day, Hope. So I think that one kind of will send them off into whatever the next, not phase technically, but the next thing they're going to do with Marvel. So I'm looking forward to that.
There's a Star Wars movie this year, too.
Oh, my God.
An actual one, really? Too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, well, that tops everything.
Episode 8.
But...
Man, they are tugging that stuff out. That's like year to year to year. Every year they're having a Star Wars movie.
It's awesome.
Yeah. I think they're doing what? Every other year it goes saga movie, standalone, saga movie, standalone. Yeah.
Wow. Well, all of them. I am excited.
All of the movies.
This is going to be great. And we have Destiny 2 this year. Man.
Oh, gosh. It doesn't even feel. I can't even think about it.
Oh, yeah. Destiny 2 on this.
No, I can't process it. Hey, I forget when my favorite TV show is coming on that day. I'm like, I'm just doing my life right now in this moment, and that's all I can handle.
Yeah.
Oh, all right. So we got, well, here's one that could be long. We'll make this just a quick one sentence answer. What's the biggest change you would make to Destiny's PvP? I guess as it stands right now.
Stands right now, I would like them to revert special back. They nerfed shotguns and snipers and then took away special ammo. Like, it just felt excessive. I think primary is in a great spot. Maybe some tweaks would be like very nitpicky, little changes here and there. But the big changes for me would be like special ammo. We get to keep that on death because shotguns are nerfed. Like in-air accuracy is kind of terrible right now. And no crit damage on the headshots. Like I think it'd be fine to give them shotgun or the special ammo on death still to keep it. That and then scories reduction, which is actually coming. So
yeah,
right. Hopefully that would be enough because that's a big issue right now, is especially in trials, literally off spawn just start sitting there. But with the whole got to get a kill first is proc it for 60 seconds. At least people have to expose themselves for a moment, you know, so.
Right. And somebody, I heard someone make a point that, you know, I guess they could, but I don't see any teams going, okay, I'm going to come out, get a kill, and then we're going to run all the way back to our spot and hide again.
Yeah, so. Probably not. Yeah.
By the way, that was...
The one change, I should say, that's not announced that I would like would be special ammo revert.
Yeah.
Keep it up. Yeah.
That was Jay Mandesender, Jordan Keller, by the way, who asked that question. And our last question is from Mr. Wilson 309.
Mr. Wilson.
And this one you referenced earlier, Lego, that we didn't touch on it. With Destiny 1 coming to a close in the foreseeable future, what have been some of your most memorable moments in Destiny 1, in-game? Anybody?
Oh, in-game, not Twitch-related or anything, just strictly game-only question? Like,
I'd say at least based on the game. Like, maybe it happened, you know, in your Twitch and that was cool, but, you know, something in-game with friends or whatever it may be.
Mm. I'll go. I'll do this one first. So, because you asked for all this. So I was going to say, I think the in-game thing for me would be the very first Trials complete flawless that I ever did. Was with, like, it was before I had like a ton of friends and it was just a random group of people, but we were down 4-4 or it was tied 4-4 for the very last win. Mercy already used, and I went to a last man standing with all three of the players left, and my super comes up and I'm Titan, Arc Titan, a striker, and I, like, it was Cathedral, I think, because I missed the first week. I can't remember what week that was. But I ran through the door, like a door had opened, all my teammates died, and I was like, I just have to do it. Like, I said, I've learned a lot since then. And I just smashed, and the shockwave went and killed all three of them. And I was like, what? Oh, I did it flawless. Like, flawless. That was the best feeling ever. Like, I'll never forget that.
That's really cool. For me, it'd be just honestly, like, it's hard to pick because it's all the firsts. Like,
yeah,
the
first, it's a lot. Like, yeah.
The first experience, the story was pretty cool, but like the first completion of Vaulted Glass, first completion of Crota, first completion of every raid, really, first flawless, all those like major milestone firsts were just so just triumphant feeling. It was so cool. I remember specifically for King's Fall, beating Oryx, like, just the screams. We're just like, ugh! We just like let it out, man. It felt so good to beat that. That's probably King's Fall because we beat it like day two. We played like 20 hours on day one trying to beat that thing. And
so long.
We had to get to sleep. We woke up, and immediately after we woke up, the entire raid team got back together and played it again. And within like, I think it was like 6 hours on day two, we beat it. And like so much time just grinding. And that was back when gear checks were a big deal with Wrath of Machine. Gear checks wasn't really a big deal. Pretty much geared for it already. I felt just casually playing through the game with the raid when I first did that one, but King's Fall was tough. You had to be coordinated, and some people were like slacking here or there, but they had to step up, and I was like, yes, he stepped up for the opportunity. They made those clutches happen, and you see the orcs just drift off to the distance, and I just sat there and didn't say a word, just watching orcs fly away. That hit me harder than Vault Glass and Crota, because those two raids I beat like a week or longer after everybody else has already beaten it. So it was like, whatever, people have already done it, but it was still like so new for King's Fall that it felt like, yes, we accomplished this. We're one of the first out there to beat this raid. Yeah. It felt good.
It's pretty awesome.
I'd say mine, there's a lot, like you said, a lot of the first, you know, first time through the story, first flawless, all that. But one that kind of sticks out to me, and it's cause it was kind of scummy maybe, but when Crota was out, I still hadn't gotten, Gjallarhorn, and it was, you have to have Gjallarhorn, blah, 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 blah. And this was before I was in Reza. I wasn't in a clan or anything. So if, like, somebody I knew wasn't on and I just wanted to, like, run it during the week, I was one of those people. Now, I practiced and I learned how to do it, you know, in the Fist of Crota message mission and everything, but I put on LFG, you know, oh, level 32 sword bearer, blah, 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 blah. Never done it in my life. And then I, like, practiced doing, like, watch some of the videos on the combos to take them down in two swords, you know? So the first time, never done it. And it took a little bit, but it was just some random people invited me. And I was like, oh, yeah, you know, do this all the time. Like, it's fine. Don't worry about it.
We did it.
Like, I did it. And it took a couple tries. It wasn't all my fault either. But first time in two swords, had never done it. And that was really cool because, like I said, if I didn't do it, then I looked like a total asshole. If anybody here is listening from that raid group, sorry, I lied to you. I wanted to carry the sword. But it was really cool because, you know, there weren't many people. Like, people were LFGing a sword bearer. Plus, I was like, yeah, I can do it in two. And they're like, you can't do it in two. I was like, oh, yeah, I do it all the time. Never done it before.
Dude, I'm excited to hear that music again that plays when you pick up the sword, whether it's you or that your teammate picks it up, and that music starts playing for that 30 seconds or whatever, however long it is that you have to down him and before the sword disappears and everything. Like, that's some epic music right there. Whatever you think about the rest of the raid, like, that moment is really great, I think.
Agreed.
I agree.
I would say mine is also Crota, and I've shared this, I think, in probably one of our favorite moments that we've had on, you know, various podcasts, but we didn't even complete Crota, but that's how I knew True Vanguard was. We were in Dads of Destiny, and we just had that, you know, raid group that we went every Tuesday with a couple other dads, and we hadn't beaten them. We were getting disconnected constantly. Nothing was going right. Like, he would disconnect carrying the sword on final approach. He'd get booted from the party. It just was, we were up to like three, and one of the wise came down and, like, just flat out was like, what are you still doing awake? And we could all hear it. And then he was just like, I just really like playing with these guys, and then offered to fold the towels or whatever else. I just thought that was, to me, because how frustrated we were and just not being able to get it done, for that to just be kind of like how we left it at 3:30 and just kind of, you know, with a bunch of levity and things like that. I mean, that's still one of my favorite moments. Is, I mean, we didn't even beat it, but just because how just the environment, just the moment, and the fact that it was just like, why we're up until 3:30 to do this, and for someone's wife to call him out, and then for him to get flustered and then be like, I'll fold these towels, don't worry about it.
I never heard awesome. The fold the towels part. Yeah, you didn't before.
That's awesome. So she comes down, she's like, what are you doing? He's like I just really like playing with these guys. And then there's just like some other speaker, you tell, like, he probably grabs the mic, so there's not like, we can't hear the other end. And then she's probably walking, he's like, I'll fold the towels. Like, I mean, if you ever ask TV about it, and I'm not gonna call it the guy that it was, he would tell you it was amazing.
That's awesome.
That conversation was just awesome.
Okay.
Well, that's all I got for questions.
Yeah. Let's move on to what we got in the TWAB and really what happened this last Wednesday in the big reveal stream. So they announced, you know, every raid brought up to this light level, a new record book. There's going to be new gear, you know, tons of stuff in the record book for both PvE and PvP players. What really stuck out to you guys? What are y'all excited for about? What are you worried about? Any first reactions?
We talked about it before. It's not something that I'm glad there's new stuff, and it'll be, well, not new, but, you know, sort of new, quasi new. But I don't know. I'm not one that, I guess, as a PvP player who, you know, in pubs, I can use whatever I want anyway. I don't really, like, I can still do the raid. Like, it doesn't have to be the light. Like, I don't know. It's cool that it's new stuff, but I just don't care that much, to be completely honest.
Yeah, but is it an Atheon that you're going to be fighting or an Atheon?
That's a good question. We'll have to ask Bungie.
I'm confused now. I don't know.
Well, speaking of that real quick, that was what our poll was this week. You know, what part of the Age of Triumph are you most excited for so far? And the overall winner by a large margin was just the old raids. Barely anybody voted for the actual rewards in the record book, and then raid weapons and meh, I'm not excited. We're pretty close.
Yeah,
but just the raids in general seems like what everyone's excited about.
That's interesting, because for me, it's the raid weapons and gear we're going to be getting, and apparently there's new gear too, which actually kind of worries me, because I like the old gear so much. I'm like, what's the difference? We don't know yet, you know, and I don't think we'll know till the end of the month what new gear and what old gear is returning. You know, that's what I'm most worried about, but also what I'm most excited about at the same time, if that makes sense.
That's fair.
Yeah, we don't know yet for sure, though, if the old gear that had elemental properties will actually have it now, right?
Exactly. Because
based on the screenshots and the trailers like that, it didn't have the whole like color scheme flash and all that stuff that the old like Fatebringer did, etc. But that doesn't necessarily mean it wasn't just not upgraded. You know, it could have just been not upgraded version in the trailer. Like, we don't really know if it will have the elemental properties or not. If it does, then I'm gonna be really excited. Just have the elemental primaries again to make strikes a lot easier. It's gonna really feel like the old school stuff. But if it's not going to include the elemental versions of those weapons, then kind of would rather just have completely brand new weapons, because having a year 3 Fatebringer that doesn't have Arcburn, or year 3 Vision Confidence that doesn't have Solar, or the year 3 Word of Crota that doesn't have Void, it's like, yeah, we have this, but this. And it just doesn't feel the same. It's not quite there for me.
Yeah, you can, I mean, it may take forever, but you can pretty much roll those guns from, you know, like whether it be the Imago Loop as like the fake bringer, you know, it just doesn't have the element. So it, right. I agree with you. It's not really as exciting.
I feel like even though we're going to be getting new gear, like they showed off some sort of new gear and said there's going to be new gear for sure, and we're guessing armor, but there's for sure going to be a Fatebringer of some sort back. They showed a Fatebringer. I mean, I guess it's not for sure, but we're pretty sure since they showed it, you know.
It is, yeah.
I mean, Deej even tweeted out Fatebringer is, people are talking about it, you know, and so right. It's coming back, you know. It's just a matter of how it's coming back. So I was kind of personally hoping that they would even bring back year 1, like other weapons too, like not just raid stuff, but just like, hey, this is the end of Destiny 1. Why not just throw in everything into the loot pool? Like you can get any of the weapons you've ever gotten from the Crucible before from the Crucible now. Like, I don't know. I think that would be awesome. I don't think that's going to happen. I think it's just going to be raid stuff, but that's my little fingers crossed, like the one thing I'm hoping might happen.
It's you dreaming again.
Yes.
I agree, though, because I think one of the biggest reasons why I'm personally not super excited about this update is, one, I'm kind of like a hardcore grinder, kind of an elitist a little bit, so I've kind of done everything already. So
yeah,
I'll be almost done with the book day 1, and I probably will be done with it by the end of week 2, and mostly on week 2 just because I have to wait for Vault of Glass challenge modes to be completed. So personally, I'm not like that excited about having, because I don't have anything like really new to do except for like some challenge modes on both raids. And the nostalgic trips, if I want to take a nostalgic trip, I can do that right now if I wanted to. But
praise the Lord, somebody agrees with me.
The biggest impact for me with this update is pretty much all the book's giving us is like some emblems, which are really cool looking emblems. Some of them are like recycled from like Halo 2. I think it was, yeah, some of the emblems, if you look back at like Halo 2 emblems, are like how it's being used in this game.
That's interesting.
I think they timed it wrong personally. I'm glad they kind of were upfront and honest about it, but I think they did the timing wrong, because when Deej announced that basically nothing is getting carried over to Destiny 2, instantly any hype for this update kind of died for a lot of people, because even if they get cool stuff in this update, it's like that, like half a year from now, probably it's not going to be relevant. So it's beforehand when those updates and like all these new things or revamp stuff, even with like old House of Wolves revamp with the April update last year, it was still like, yes, you know, it had a, like, this will, I'll always have this gear. Like, I don't even care them doing Prison of Elders again. I get cool new gear with it. I can use this gear forever. But now we're like, we can do all these other things again, but this gear I only use for a few months, and then it's not going to matter at all. And then we're just going to do Destiny 2. As that's kind of like, so for me, this update is literally just going to be like, I'll just do the book to be a completionist, look at some cool emblems, complete the challenge mode just so I can feel like I complete the challenge and have that sense of accomplishment. And then that's pretty much it. I really am not that enthused about gear, because it's going to be irrelevant in like half a year's time.
Yeah, I'm gonna take the flip side of that like feeling for a second, just for a second. Is the
just to see how it feels.
No. So, because it's something that I heard somebody else say. There's two things. One, with them announcing it right now and the timing on the DCP podcast, they were talking about how, I think it was them anyway, they were talking about how by announcing that right now, it's like ripping the Band-Aid off real quick of like, hey, this is the negative side of Destiny 2. And from here on out, it's going to be positive. Hey, you're not taking your stuff, rip the Band-Aid off. Okay, now that that pain is over, we're going to start releasing Destiny 2 news soon, and it's all going to be good stuff. We don't want to have to tell you this and it detract from your excitement once we start telling you all the good news. And so there's that kind of side of it. And then there's also the side, which is for me, I feel like more personally what I feel. And that's, you know, I'm just excited to get this gear again and play around with it. Like in Trials of Osiris or in, you know, Nightfall or something where it matters, like light level matters, which I don't really do Nightfalls, but I will use them in Trials of Osiris. Like taking Praetorian foil, like that is like a dream of mine. I tried using the low light version of it in Trials and it is so freaking difficult. And so I got some kills and it was fun, but not that fun. And so like I'm excited for that, and like the whole point of a game is to play it, you know, in the time that we have it. And so like in that way, like I think it's fine, you know, to tell us now. It doesn't really affect me in any way, but I could see how it would affect, you know, like I'm sure there are plenty of people who feel the way that you just said, Chad, about how like, well, I don't really want to go get those things now because I can just wait till Destiny 2. So
yeah, and part of that is you can't really have that mindset about everything because there's kind of a limit to everything. So if you thought about that, then you'd have the same mindset when Destiny 2 comes out as why would you bother getting the gear in Destiny 2 because they're going to be Destiny 3
exactly
sometime. So it is that feeling that you need to strive for of obtaining accomplishments. And that's why I was talking about doing things for the sense of achievement and saying I accomplished those things and got those things.
Mm-hmm.
I do like your thought though before of like if they're going to give us this year one stuff and revamp everything for this last hurrah, do it like everything as the last hurrah, not just specific little things. Or
please,
like what I feel like would be like a watered down version of a Fatebringer. Just give us the regular Fatebringer. Just make a year three, like everything. Just throw it all in. Most people are not going to play Destiny 1 beyond like a year from now anyway. So just throw it all in there. Let's do everything right.
Yeah,
now.
And not only that, but we have Zalo now that is Arcburn. Why not make the raid elementals exotic? And that's like the same thing, you know, yeah. Like anything
that
like that.
Weird to me that we have Zalo right now, but not any other primary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, what? Why weird. Is this here? Like, it's so weird to me that this stands out like that.
Trent, what do you feel about all this?
I mean, I'm pretty indifferent. I mean, we thought that this is something they should do. I think Lego, me and you are in the camp, like it seems like it would be like easy for them to do this. So I mean, it just makes sense that they would do this. They're kind of throwing us a bone. I'm definitely in the camp that if you're going to do this, don't do it halfway. Please just, you know, do it all the way and, you know, bring up the light level. But I mean, just no one really needs to get to 400. So like if you might not need to go to 400 at this point. So like, there's no real benefit to me to getting the gear. I mean, you know, pun intended, I'd move on to other horizons during the day. So I don't really, I'm not playing this game a lot.
Oh my
so
gosh.
I don't know about like how much I'm going to do or how much like a record book emblem means to me. But I mean, it's a nice thing. It's a free thing. So you know, I'm not going to bash anything that falls under that category. But, you know, my personal level of excitement is not too high because, I mean, I think a lot of people may come back. But I mean, I have a hard time finding six people to play PvP. So I don't know what it's going to be like, you know, 3-4 weeks out, you know, once he's dropped, to find people to do these necessarily, or at least people that I play with normally. I definitely don't want to have to do an LFG or something like that. So I think, you know, it's fun to do and it's free. And so it's nice for the people, but you know, please do it all the way. And you know, I just don't know how much this is actually going to extend the game for me. You know, I pretty much play regularly anyways.
Yeah. Something that I was thinking about with everything that they've talked about, I'm going to, like, this is getting a little bit into the TWAB, like, other than the Wednesday Twitch stream, but they said it in the stream, and then Deej said it again in the TWAB, that they're adding some mayhem to Nightfalls. And oh, yeah. And he specifically used that exact wording again in the TWAB, and I was like, man, like, they've got to do something like they've been doing with, I don't know. Like people have thrown out the idea before where like, what if like you literally put the advantages you have in Mayhem Crucible modes, like in a Nightfall where your super was just up all the time. And everyone was talking about how fun it was to go into unlimited super Sunbreaker and just shoulder charge through the entire strike. You know, like what if they gave us something that made us just feel so incredibly powerful in the Nightfall sometime? I feel like it's got to be something like that, you know, for him to keep saying it like that. Maybe it's just new challenge modes or something, but I don't know. And my point of the whole thing, Hove, was you had mentioned, you know, you're not really sure how it's going to help you enjoy the game that much more. But when they put strike scoring in and made it like, I don't know, strikes just seem more fun all of a sudden. Maybe they're going to do something to make Nightfalls more fun and actually get you playing PvE, which is weird because that never happens. But it did happen.
Yeah, I played like 6 Nightfalls this year. I agree. I do agree with you, though. And I was just talking mostly about bringing back the old raids and everything, because I never understood that whole thing. I can still do them. There was never a point that I couldn't go do them. You know, I don't know. But, you know, Chad brought up a good point, you know, going into Destiny 2 and all that. Like, you're never going to be able to keep the things forever. Like, I see both sides of the not wanting to get new stuff now that you're going to have to get rid of in 6 months, but when does it become not worth it? Is it 6 months that you don't want to grind for something and get rid of it? Is it a year? Like Destiny 1, like the first day, I was never going to keep that stuff forever. Like it was going to be a new game. Do you get what I'm saying? Like when does it become too short of a time that you don't care about getting something? I guess.
I mean, for me, it's never. I'm curious what the answer is for you guys. Like for me, if it was like a week, it's like, yeah, well, I played the game for a week. So that I play most games for like 3 days and then I finish it and I never touch it again. And Destiny, I've been playing for 3 years. So...
I think it would be different, just
based on your perspective and desires and stuff. So I don't think there would be like one answer for everyone.
Right. For sure.
Yeah, that was kind of more just like a, you know, they can't please everybody. That's what I learned from Destiny.
Oh my gosh.
But you're right. No, it's going to differ for everyone. So
what is it for you guys though? Like Hove said, I'm curious.
What, how long?
Yeah.
I don't know. For me, like a lot of what I'm focusing on right now is just as long as I'm having fun. So I don't know how long it's going to be too long or not long enough for me. Honestly, I'm probably going to get like all the things I want to get within a few weeks and then I'll probably call it. I'm in a very blessed circumstance where I can probably rally around a team of 6 people if I needed to. And get through this activities, get the rewards, get the gear, get the stuff I want. It probably won't take me until the end. So for my perspective, it would be, I'm probably going to get within like a month, everything I want, even with like bad RNG, I probably would get all the weapons I'd want within about a month, maybe 2 months longest. I'd have to be really unlucky if I do all the raids on all 3 characters every single week. And then after like 2 months, I still don't have the weapons I want, which is possible. I mean, we know how Gjallarhorn went in year one, but, I feel like, for the most part, get all the things I want.
That reminds me of something they said in the update too. They said that it's going, the new gears are gonna, the new gear drops are better, basically, in the new revamped raids. They actually said that, so that's awesome. Exciting.
Yeah.
Like for me too, though. Like I was kind of talking about earlier was how I kind of already have things. If I want to do nostalgia, I already can do the nostalgia. You can't really use the Praetorian foil in trials right now. So having a year 3 version would be dope if you want to use that in trials. Me personally, I don't really have personal agenda to use any of that raid stuff in trials or anything like that. I don't really have a personal agenda to use that raid stuff in any kind of content unless it has elemental damage properties on the primaries. Then I would want to use them like a Nightfall. But then I'd ask myself what I really want from Nightfall. Enough to get an icebreaker, so I don't really want to do that anyway. So I don't really have an ambition to do strikes or Nightfalls right now, unless maybe something that they provide in this update on Wednesday coming up, the whole weekly thing that they're going to talk about. Maybe there'll be a new reason to do strikes and Nightfalls, in which case then I would want elemental primaries. Then I would have a reason to get all those things. Sure. So I don't have enough information to properly answer that question right now.
Yeah.
But as it stands, what I know now of definites, probably I'm just going to do the stuff, say I accomplished it, and then move on to trials and more variety during the week. That's probably what I'm going to be doing.
And more Horizons.
More Horizons.
Oh, God. The game is awesome.
be like an Andromeda around me, man.
Nice.
My decisions will have a mass effect on my
Oh man.
Yeah, move to something else and get a fresh Breath of the Wild or something.
Yep.
Exactly. Oh, you're this is awesome. I can't do this.
Oh man. For me, it's like diminishing returns. Like I'm not going to chase anything. And I mean, there's really no amount of time that would matter for me. Like, I mean, Destiny 2 can come out next month and I'll just get whatever I get until then, or it can come out in December of this year and I'll just get what I get until then. Like, the same way that I think Chad kind of hit on, like, there's not an incentive to play Nightfalls or Strikes. And even though Strike scoring is not like that old, I mean, I would have played the crap out of Strike scoring in like year one or two, you know, leading up to things. But now it's like, you know, you play the same Strike. It doesn't matter if you get a couple of medals and you just kind of move on. So,
well, being the one thing that was kind of nice for me that got me playing a few Nightfalls. I mean, six was like a lot. Maybe
that
it was
a lot for you, Hope.
I know. Just the Strike scoring. Like, I did most of them with the two of you, and to be able to get to like the end screen and go, fuck yeah, look at your score. Mine's better. You suck. Get good. That made me feel good. You know?
Wow. It was fun though. I don't know what it is about it, but it's fun. Even if I don't look at the score, it's fun just seeing the numbers pop up.
Yeah. I was going to say, we've touched on many times before. I'm like a small child, bright colors, loud noises. Those get me excited. So like the more things that pop up on the screen and like tell me I did something, I don't even look what they are. I don't even know how I did it, but I'm like, yeah, I did that. Check it out. Look what I did.
Like, yeah. Lastly, they also, so we talked about, you know, just hinted at it for a second there, but this week, you know, they're going to show off the, you know, what the weekly ritual is going to be. There's a House of Judgment icon in there, and there's, you know, a raid icon and a crucible. I have no idea what they're bringing. And then the week after that is going to be the sandbox and gear. They were really, I feel like they worded it really poorly or something, because I was confused about what like at first they said, we'll show you what the sandbox is going to be. And I was like, is it just the crucible patch with scories that they're going to talk about? Like, that seems weird for stream, but no. He kind of clarified in this one, I think it's like the loot you're going to be getting. They're not showing any of that until next week's stream, it looks like. So some stuff to look forward to there. The only other thing they said in the TWAB is they clarified there's not going to be any new vault space. That's pretty much the one highlight from the TWAB that I got, which I don't really care, but I know some people do a whole lot.
I do find it odd that they're going to tell us, there's all this new stuff to collect. And they know that some people have had issues, and they said they were looking into vault space. And they're like, oh, we're going to give you all this new stuff and no vault space. Bye. Like, I thought that was odd.
I think for a lot of people, they just replace their former versions of gear and just replace it with a year free version for the most part.
If it's elemental, anyway.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
honestly, if I get... I'm going to tell you right now, if I get a Fatebringer from Vault of Glass and the Fatebringers for this version doesn't have an elemental damage, I'm just going to trash it. I just have no desire to get it.
Yeah.
Like, the Fatebringer gun itself in the meta and its archetype is not to par with things like Palindrome and Eyes Luna. Even for PvE standards, it's just not worth it. So a lot of the weapons and raid stuff, a lot of the raid weapons were really not worth it. And somebody was talking to me before about how... they really enjoyed how the Vault of Glass and Crota raid weapons, everybody was excited. They're like, we want these raid weapons. We want them so much. And we grinded for those raid weapons. But in King's Fall and Wrath of the Machine, most of the weapons were pretty much just whatever. Outbreak Prime is probably the thing that stands out the most of the raid weapons. And that was an exotic. I mean, pretty much all the legendary raid weapons that I can think of right now were not a big deal. Cocoon had like a little bit of a cheese effect for it. It was like convenient for laser gamers like myself. I just didn't feel like reloading, so I used it. But if I got around and like actually reloaded my weapons, it wasn't really that optimal to run Cocoon weapons. And I basically never ran King's Fall weapons for anything. And I didn't really run Wrath of Machine weapons for anything except for Outbreak Prime against Fallen. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah.
But the big reason why that's happening is because there's no elemental damage for a lot of it, because if you look at the Vault of Glass and Crota weapons taking away elemental damage, how many of you would really use those primaries if it didn't have elemental damage compared to other primaries available? Not really. Like, it just wasn't really worth it. It wasn't that big of a deal. but the elemental damage was why I was like, we need these weapons. I need a grind for a fate bringer now. I need that word of a Crota for my thorn bounty. Like, I need that, you know? So hopefully they have the elemental damage. Otherwise, the big draw for them is just not going to be there for me.
Right.
Yeah, I definitely can relate to that, because the last raid thing that I remember wanting was the Yasmin. And I was like, man, I really want that sniper. And it was just for the scope, you know, and that was kind of it. Like, everything, like, there was nothing in Wrath of the Machine that I was like, man, I really want that. And I just played it a few times and it was a fun raid. I liked the raid. There just wasn't anything in there that I wanted, you know.
Well, I think
worthy outside of Outbreak.
Right. And I think one of the things, though, and they kind of screwed themselves early by making the elemental primaries and Vault of Glass and everything, and then realizing that's all anyone would use. If they wouldn't have done that in the first place, I don't think you would have ever had an issue. But the other thing, like, especially with Wrath of the Machine, they're good weapons, but they're good for the raid and PvE stuff. And we look at it, and, you know, most of us are, you know, play a lot of PvP. I'm not going to use that scout rifle, you know, in trials, but against a boss, you know, in that raid, stuff like that. Like, they were good. They fit the raid well.
They did.
Super useful outside of it, I guess.
Even for the raid, though, when I run raids, I go with a sword or Galahorn for a heavy, and then I'll go with the Outbreak Prime for all the way up until the boss fight, the Axis fight, and then I switch my Outbreak Prime for the Palindrome, the vendor version, because that's spray and play, and it can one hit the shanks, so hella optimal. So Outbreak Prime, because it does hella damage, but doesn't apply to Axis for whatever reason, so I switch to Palindrome, so I can one hit shanks. I think some scout rifles with high impact might be able to one hit as well, but I haven't done the raid much to practice all of those.
Right.
And then for my sniper, I just for my special, I just ran the LDR. I have an LDR role that had spray and play and had high ammo capacity and all that stuff. So I, even to optimize for the Wrath of the Machine, I never ran anything but the Alpic Prime. And then for King's Fall, every time I ran it was sleeper simulant, and then sniper rifle. I think I ran the 1,000 yard. I just ran the vendor roll 1,000 yard that had triple tap and mulligan on it. And then primary, I just ran whatever primary felt like fun, which was, I ran the scout rifle from King's Fall, but most of that reason why I ran that King's Fall scout rifle was because I had Cocoon. I was lazy. So if I was actually actively reloading weapons, I didn't run that one. I ran the Hung Jury instead.
Yeah, I think the King's Fall weapons were a pretty big misstep. I don't think any of them were. You know, the heavy machine gun was good if you wanted a heavy machine gun, and the sniper was decent for what it was, but yeah, those weapons were kind of a flop, I thought.
I think the perk idea for it, though, like the idea of Cocoon was really good, the same way that trials having snapshot on all of those, you know, adept weapons was really cool. Like those are good ideas, like things that like help you. It's just the weapons themselves could have used something.
And Wendler in chat said, just real quick, he said he hasn't posted it, but he said he has a link where Deej infers that the burns will stay on the weapons.
I like that there's something that infers it, though it's not official, so I can't ever trust 100%.
Yeah, I feel the same way. That is exciting, though.
But I do like that he infers it somewhere. I would like to see that link.
Me too.
If he doesn't post it in chat, then you can whisper it maybe to me. Yeah. I'd like to see that.
Do it, Wendler.
Come on, Wendler.
Yeah, I think the ideas behind the King's Fall weapons and the Wrath of Machine weapons are really cool. Cocoon is a really cool, unique perk. I really like that, especially since I'm a kind of a lazy gamer after I grind for so many hours every day. Just makes it convenient for me. And then Wrath of the Machine makes it easier to do stuff in that raid with those weapons. I thought it was so cool that the weapons transform as you upgrade them.
That was cool.
Cool aesthetic. So the idea behind those two raid weapons are amazing, but at the end of the day, if you want to optimize, you didn't really run those weapons compared to other stuff. But you know, I don't know.
We'll see what they do. I'm really curious. Well, we've talked a lot tonight about a lot of different things. This is a great podcast. Thank you so much, Chadlantis, for coming on.
Yeah, thanks. It was a good time.
Thanks for having me.
It was so awesome having you here, man. Hove, Triton, do y'all have anything else to add to this before we shut it down? No. Let's do it. Okay. Well, this has been Lego, aka Legole Flash. You can find me on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube at Lego LE Flash. Love to talk with you, hang out with you, do some fusion rifling, vooping with you. Hove, where can they find you?
Same thing, Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, all at Hove76. It's HOV76.
And you can Triton. Find me in all those places, all under Triton Please, the please being PLZ. And how about you, Chad?
Twitch and YouTube is Chadlantis. Twitter, Instagram is Chadlantis TV. Apparently, Lantis is the last name, so there's a guy named Chadlantis who made a Twitter and Instagram account and never uses it. I'm sad about it.
We're all going to come after this and hug him a little bit. Hey, man, come on. and you can also find REZOcast at REZOcast on Twitter and on YouTube. And, you know, you can listen to us on iTunes or YouTube or Google Play, wherever your heart desires. We'd love to have you leave us a review if you enjoyed the episode. I know it's so difficult to get to it in iTunes, but please, we really appreciate those reviews. Hope, where can they find more about Resolute?
On a Twitter, at Team Resolute, and on Twitch at twitch.tv/ResoluteGamers.
Awesome. Well, this has been REZOcast episode 25 with Chadlantis. Thanks so much for joining us, guys. And until next time, GG.
GG's.